Good evening. I'm Noreen Hirsfeld, the Nicholas and Bernice Reuter Professor of Science and Religion, and it's my pleasure tonight to introduce to you two men who probably need very little introduction. The meteorologist Paul Douglas and broadcast journalist Gary Eichten. And I was trying to add things up as we walked over here. I think between the two of them, they have about 90 years of broadcasting experience.
Paul has about 85, I have five.
It feels like 85, yes.
Paul Douglas received his meteorology degree from my alma mater, Penn State. And many of you may know him from watching CARE TV back in the 90s or WCCO TV in the 2000s. Or you may read his daily report in the Star Tribune or his weather blog for the St. Cloud Times. Now, what you may not know is that in 2005, he became Minnesota's first certified broadcast meteorologist by the American Meteorological Society. That's a mouthful. He's also an entrepreneur. He's the primary mover in at least four companies: Meteorologic Group, which disseminates weather reports to a variety of media; Singular Logic, which is attempting to give consumers more control over the ads they see. I'm waiting for that one. Smart Energy, which fine-tunes weather forecasts for wind farms and other energy concerns. And The Legal Storm, which does forensic meteorology. By the way, Paul's real last name is Kruhofer, a name he was told would be too hard for DJs to pronounce, but one that's right at home here in Stearns County. Interviewing Paul tonight is our very own alumnus, Gary Eichten, the longtime host of the award-winning Midday on NPR. Tonight's interview is part of a series on campus with Gary Eichten, and it will be broadcast at noon and at 9 on Wednesday. And because of that broadcast, I'd like you all to make sure that your cell phones are turned off so that you don't find that your particular tune is ringing out at 12:25 across the airwaves. So, despite the evening's temperature, I'd like to ask you all to please join me in giving a warm welcome to Paul Douglas and Gary Eichten.
Thank you. Thanks, Noreen. You know, unless something dramatic happens between now and November 8th, we will have a stark choice to make when we vote for president, at least on the issue of climate change. Both Democrats apparently favor full speed ahead on dealing with climate change. All three leading Republicans say it can wait, if it's an issue at all. Democrats say the future of the planet is at stake. Republicans say the future of our economy is at stake. Once again, familiar partisan battle lines being drawn, but Mr. Douglas here, Paul Douglas, he is the odd duck who defies all those easy stereotypes. Paul is a Republican, he's an evangelical Christian, but he also firmly believes that climate change is a real and serious threat. Paul is an entrepreneur, he is a TV weather legend, he's a computer graphics whiz. You might know that he worked with Steven Spielberg on Jurassic Park, and he's also a heck of a nice guy. And Paul, thanks for coming out.
Thank you, Gary. It's great to be here.
I would be remiss, Paul, if I didn't note that temperatures outside are plunging, winds are howling, and here we are talking about global warming.
The irony is not lost on me. It's 12 degrees here. And what is it about our caveman DNA? We look out the window, and people come up to me and say, Paul, I'm cold. How can the planet be warming if I'm cold? Please explain. You have 12 seconds. So, you know, we have a semantics challenge. You know, global warming gives the illusion, the impression that everybody's warming up simultaneously worldwide, and the planet is warming. 14 of the 15 warmest years worldwide since 2000. The odds of that happening are 650 million to one. The oceans are warming. 92% of that excess warming is going into the oceans. We're conducting an experiment. And then you say, well, okay, it's climate change. Actually, George Bush's advisors suggested shifting from global warming to climate change because it wouldn't sound quite as scary. And people say, well, Paul, the climate has always changed. We've had ice ages, you know. I go, yes, that's true. The climate responds to forcings. The orbit around the sun wobbles in the Earth's orbit. It responds to volcanic eruptions. It responds to solar radiation. And it responds to CO2. And right now, we've increased CO2 levels by about 43% in the last 150 years. 100 times faster than any time in the geological record. We have ice core samples going back 800,000 years. It's the rate of change and the fact that we are tinkering with the atmosphere. We are messing with the chemistry of the atmosphere. We are conducting an experiment that hasn't been done before. I prefer climate volatility, weather disruption. Doesn't roll off the tongue. But I think that describes at least what I'm seeing, what climate scientists are seeing, more volatility in the system, and there are symptoms. And those symptoms now are showing up in the weather.
So you're a layman. I'm a layman, I should say. And you and most scientists say, yes, indeed, there's a situation that's developed here. But some scientists and all of the Republican candidates, presidential candidates, dismiss it. How can I know that you're right?
Well, if I'm suffering from cancer and I go to an oncologist and 98 or 99 out of 100 oncologists give me the same general diagnosis and the same treatment, I'm going to listen to those 98 oncologists. I'm not going to listen to the guy in the back holding up magnets and duct tape and pseudo-babble, pseudoscience. The problem right now, and Upton Sinclair, I think, summed it up beautifully. He said, it's hard to get a man to believe something when his salary depends on him not believing. And there's so much money right now in the political system, and these candidates, all of them on both sides, with the exception of Bernie Sanders, I have to give him credit for that, but certainly on the Republican side, these men and women are dependent on campaign donations, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars. And they don't want to do anything to upset the apple cart and in any way impact those campaign donations. That's the lifeblood of their campaigns. Mm-hmm. And the last figure I saw, 90 cents of every dollar of fossil fuel campaign donations has gone to Republican candidates, not to the Democrats.
How big of a problem do you see this to be when you compare it to, you know, income inequality, poverty, ISIS, on and on and on? Where does climate change rank?
I tell people, my opinion, it's not a heart attack. It's not the end of the world. It's more of a perpetual planetary migraine. But a migraine that flavors other conflicts and skirmishes and issues. And this is why the military takes it very seriously. They call it a threat multiplier. There is not much denial in the Air Force, the Navy, the Army, the Marines. They see what's happening and they see the additional stress it's putting on their infrastructure, their supply chains, and they are girding themselves for this volatility, because they know that if countries run out of water, if they suddenly can't grow food, you think the refugee migration problem is a crisis today? Give it 10 years, give it 20 years. What happens when a country runs out of water? Where do these people go? So it's a problem that flavors other problems. And it's not to minimize the other very real issues we have as a nation. Yes, who in their right mind isn't worried about ISIS? Mm-hmm. Who doesn't have an opinion about immigration? Income inequality. But as a country, we've been able to do more than one thing at a time. As a nation, I think we're capable of riding our bikes and chewing gum. We can figure out solutions while addressing these other very pressing issues as well.
Big climate conference in Paris in December. Nations signing on, pledging serious action to deal with the climate change issue. Are they actually going to do anything?
That remains to be seen. I'm hopeful. I'm optimistic. It doesn't have any legal teeth, but I see the steps that countries in Europe, I see the steps that China is taking. You know, when people say, well, we don't need regulation. Who needs regulation? We are overregulated. Let the markets run unhindered. And I say, well, there is a place where they tried that. You can't breathe the air. You can't drink the water. You can't eat the food. Other than that, things are going quite well in China. Do we want to be China? And they are rapidly weaning themselves off. They're trying to. They have a Herculean challenge in raising up the middle class, trying to prevent the regime from toppling. At the same time, they're trying to clean up their energy sources. So they are trying to come off coal. They have added a tremendous amount of renewable power, significantly more than we have. So I think the world is still looking to the United States for leadership and to prove once again that American exceptionalism is something more than just a campaign slogan.
Let me go back to this issue of the folks in this country who just don't believe that there is a problem, or apparently don't believe it. Ted Cruz, a leading Republican presidential candidate, said on National Public Radio here a couple of months ago that climate change is basically an issue fabricated by liberals to grow the size of government. Now, you're a Republican. Is there some truth to what Senator Cruz is saying?
Anecdotally, I've heard a story as told to me by another climate scientist that I respect, who said that James Inhofe, the senator from Oklahoma, at one point acknowledged that yes, in fact, the climate was changing until somebody whispered in his ear what it would cost. And then he changed his tune. I think there is a natural knee-jerk reflex that, oh my goodness, if this is really what they say it is, the only solution is more government, more bureaucracy, more regulation, EPA times 100. That's initially where their brains go. That's the only way we can deal with this, when in fact, this is, if we figure this out and if we're smart about this, this will be a renaissance. This will be a chance for renewal and reinvention. And this will spawn thousands of new companies, millions of better paying jobs than the fossil fuel industry, and this will be a sustainable way forward. It's disruptive. But ultimately, we have to find sustainable ways to keep the lights on, keep people employed, and keep the economy powered up. So I understand the reticence. I understand the concerns, the paranoia that only government can address this. And there is a role for government. There is a role for regulation. But the more that we can empower markets and prime the pump to create 100 more Teslas, what are the companies that are going to take us into the future? You know, we've been sucking dinosaur juice out of the ground for a couple of hundred years. It's convenient. It's been relatively cheap, but it's not sustainable. It's like smoking 3 packs a day and waking up one morning and going, you know, I did this for 20 years, but it's not sustainable. We didn't come out of the Stone Age because we ran out of stones. We came out of the Stone Age because we found a better way forward. When I was growing up, when they were sending men to the moon, we called that progress. And I still think there is a way to turn a negative, a threat, into an opportunity to reinvent our energy economy and to create a sustainable, a truly independent way to keep the lights on. Why on earth would we want to be dependent on price spikes and dips in perpetuity. Why on earth would we want to be dependent on countries that don't like us very much, from Saudi Arabia to Iran to Venezuela? We have the technology. We have the entrepreneurs. Young people get it. There's not much pushback from anybody under the age of 30, give or take. What has been lacking is political will.
I wanted to ask you a couple of other questions that grew out of that interview Senator Cruz gave to National Public Radio. He says that satellite data proves there is no global warming. Proves it. And apparently this came up at a Senate committee hearing, so on and so forth. Is that true?
It's a fundamental misunderstanding of technology on Senator Cruz's part. Satellites infer temperatures. They aren't physically measuring temperatures at various altitudes of the atmosphere. You have a satellite in low Earth orbit, and it's peering through the entire layer of the atmosphere, inferring what the temperature is at the surface, 10,000 feet, 20,000 feet. And what's ironic is that just as the climate scientists predicted 150 years ago, this is not new science. You can go back to the late 1880s. A Swede, Arrhenius, actually theorized that if you keep pumping greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, the lower atmosphere will warm, the upper atmosphere will actually cool. And that's exactly what we're seeing. So you've got these satellites that are peering through the atmosphere, the cooling upper atmosphere, the stratosphere, and inferring what's happening near the ground. The best measurements, the most accurate measurements, are the measurements that are being made on the surface of the Earth. But Gary, this doesn't rest on one thread of evidence. 92% of the world's glaciers are melting. The world's oceans are warming and rising. The polar ice cap has melted 40%, the summer ice cap. In your lifetime, you'll be able to sail across the North Pole. I mean, we're seeing so many strands of evidence. It doesn't rest on one single thread. So, again, people are saying what they're being paid to say, and they're following the campaign donations, and they're following dogma and ideology, which is straight out of the 1950s.
But the skeptics, deniers, whatever you want to call them, they would argue that, in fact, all these scientists are on the dole, that they're making up these theories. They're coming up with these theories as a good way to win big government grants, keep themselves in business.
Oh, living the high life? Because, you know, I can't tell you how many scientists I see driving Lamborghinis into the lab, you know, that... I get your point, but first of all, people who study science because they love science. They have a passion for science. They aren't doing it to get rich. They could make 2, 3, 5 times more money or more in the private sector. Look at the average salary of a scientist. These folks, they're doing okay, but they're not in the 1%. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. This notion that you have thousands of climate scientists, PhDs, and their staff, and every major scientific organization on the planet somehow conspiring to make this a reality and to mislead the global population. I go, really? Our government somehow sponsoring this global conspiracy? Our government can't even launch a website. I'm sorry. I don't see it. I don't see it. I think it's intellectually lazy. It's sort of the TMZ of the human brain, right? I mean, it's conspiracy theories are fun. But it's the same people who say, well, we didn't. How can you prove that we really walked on the moon? Right, that whole Apollo moon landing thing? And Washington is made up of a race of lizard people. That one may be true. But I'm suspect when it comes to conspiracy theories. There are multiple strands of evidence, and this touches so many different areas. I talked to farmers around the state, and some of them are afraid to call it climate change for fear of alienating their peers. They want to belong to the tribe. They don't want to do anything to upset the apple cart. But after my talks, they'll come up to me one-on-one and say, Paul, I don't know what you call it, but something has changed in my fields. The patterns have shifted. The rains are falling harder in the summer. More pests. It's not my grandfather's weather. And this is what got me interested in this. Mm-hmm. I didn't wake up and have an epiphany. This had nothing to do with Al Gore and Inconvenient Truth. Back in the late 90s, I noticed that the patterns were changing. The weather was changing. And the weather has always been erratic. We've always had ups and downs. Of course, we've had storms and floods and droughts. But this was a new flavor of average. Suddenly, it was like the seasons were on fast forward, and somebody had turned the volume of extreme weather up to a 10. Something had changed, and that's what pulled me into the peer-reviewed science, and I began connecting the dots and saying, this is either the mother of all coincidences, or it's real. And that would be my answer to the perpetual denialist. This is either the greatest scientific hoax ever perpetrated on mankind, or it's real.
What do you say to your fellow evangelicals, many of whom have real trouble with this theory of climate change and man-made problems and the rest? What do you say to them?
I would say that we have rights in this country and we have responsibilities. And God gave us free will. I believe it. Genesis, in the Bible, it says that we were made in God's self-image. He gave us big, beautiful brains, the ability to think logically, make decisions, try to improve our lives, and have the good sense not to foul our nest. This comes down to stewardship. You know, we're supposed to just not only care for ourselves and our families. Christ said, you're supposed to care for everybody. Matthew 25:45, whatever you did not do for the least of these, you did not do for me. And increasingly, and I think the Pope, you know, God bless him, Pope Francis came out with a very strong encyclical, called it the way it is. And I know he ruffled some feathers, but nobody has the right to pollute with impunity. You know, the free market, and I believe me, I'm a markets guy. I'm a businessman. I'm a serial entrepreneur. I believe in the power of the markets to invent new solutions, to bring down prices. But nobody has the right to pollute in perpetuity. And in my mind, it's a fundamental injustice because fossil fuel companies are basically putting their interests ahead of the common good. Now, we've all benefited from fossil fuels, all of us. We wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for fossil fuels. But it's not sustainable. And right now, the fossil fuel industry is being disrupted. They're pushing back. And a little bit of misinformation, a lot of misinformation, is good for business.
What about the argument, though, Paul, that changes in the natural order are part of God's plan? It is arrogant of mankind to think that they can manipulate this plan.
We've already done a pretty good job of manipulating the planet. Again, God gave us the ability to make smart, long-term decisions and short-sighted, selfish decisions. And the question is, will greed win out, or will we find ways to keep the lights on, keep people employed, keep the economy powered up? I refuse to believe, Gary, that the country that cured polio and fought two fascist regimes simultaneously in World War II and sent men to the moon, mapped the human genome, invented the internet, can't find ways to keep things going without polluting. A lighter footprint on the planet. And again, we are called to be stewards. Luke 16:2, man has been appointed as a manager for God's property, and ultimately he will be held accountable for his management. So I think you can be selective in how you quote scripture, but I think all of us are called to be stewards, and all of us are called to help other people. Those with the least, the developing countries, the third world countries, are already feeling the effects of this. 150 million people live within 3 feet of sea level. To them, climate change is not some abstraction. It's not some political talking point on CNN. If you live in Bangladesh, if you live in a field in Africa that's drying up before your eyes, if you have no water supply, if you can't grow your crops, this is more than just, well, you get my point.
I'm going to bring it home here to Minnesota, and then we'll get to some audience questions. So get your questions ready, and we'll get you included in this conversation. But I want to ask you about Minnesota. What changes should we be looking for here on the home front, and when will our lives be turned upside down? And is it such a bad thing to have it a little warmer?
Touché. You could probably run for office on a pro-global warming platform, right? And let me say something that maybe you didn't expect. Overall, looking out the next 10 to 20 years, a warming climate will be good for Minnesota. Not to minimize the stresses on agriculture and the whiplash between drought and flood. We're going to have to be much more resilient. We're going to have to find new ways to deal with invasive species and pests. But overall, this will be good for the northern tier states of the United States, from Seattle to Minneapolis to St. Paul to Boston, although Boston has the sea level rise to contend with. So this will actually help our economy. And some of those friends and neighbors who moved to Fort Myers and Scottsdale, they're coming back. Mm-hmm. You may not like that, but they're coming back. But that's also part of the meme that a lot of people on the right like to relate. Well, this is going to require incredible sacrifices, and the prices will spike dramatically. Energy, everything will cost more if we get serious about this. And it's just bunk. This notion that you have to shave your head and ride a bicycle and become a vegetarian and live in a yurt. No. We will come up with the solutions collectively. I don't have the answer key, but collectively, this country does have the answer key. If you can unleash the market forces, we can figure this out. And Gary, we will invent the new technologies that ultimately get exported to the rest of the world. We
how
can help other
that,
countries.
How long is that going to take when somebody comes up with the answer?
I think it's going to happen a lot faster than skeptics believe. It's already happening. With no formal price on carbon, already the markets are reacting. Today, some would say that we're still not going fast enough, and we do need to go faster. Because the question is not, are we going to continue warming? The question is, will it be a degree and a half or 2 degrees Celsius, or will it be 8 degrees? We can adapt to 2 degrees. It'll be unpleasant at times, but we will adapt. 8 degrees, different planet.
Paul Douglas is our guest, legendary TV meteorologist, computer whiz, serial entrepreneur, Republican, evangelical, here to talk about climate change. All right, ready for some audience questions. Anybody want to go first? We have a gentleman down here, down front with a question. In the mic, please, so we can get you on the radio.
Coral Reef, can you talk a little bit about the increasing in CO2s? That's really on the major agenda, I think, for our concern.
Right.
And what might happen?
Right. And again, CO2 has spiked about 42%. And we have ice core samples going back 800,000 years from Greenland, from Antarctica. So we can drill down a mile or two, extract those ice core samples, go in and look at CO2 concentrations going back, you know, many, many millennia. And during the course of history, CO2 levels were between 180 and 280 parts per million. We just passed 400 parts per million last year. And the question is, are we going to 500? Are we going to 600? We have put an additional 500 billion tons of greenhouse gases, man-made greenhouse chemicals, into the atmosphere. That's 500 billion hot air balloons of greenhouse gases. So we're tinkering with the chemical composition of the atmosphere and crossing our fingers and clicking our heels and hoping that everything turns out fine. But if it doesn't turn out fine, you know, what do we say to our kids and our grandkids? And the question too is positive feedbacks. What happens as you continue to melt the Arctic? Could you have a runaway greenhouse effect? Now, I don't subscribe to all the gloom and doom, believe it or not, but I do know that underwater frozen forms of carbon have already begun to start melting. Permafrost is melting, so we're releasing more methane, which is 21 times stronger than CO2. We don't know what we don't know. And I think that's what keeps many climate scientists up at night. You know, we think we have all the answers. People say, do you believe in climate change? No. I believe in Christ. I believe in absolutes. You don't believe the science, you test the science. And the more we test the science, the answers we get back are consistent with gradual warming of the oceans, the cryosphere, and the atmosphere. The atmosphere is only 4% of the Earth's system. 92% of that heat is going into the oceans. I just read this morning the El Nino, which is going on, now the biggest on record, bigger than 97, 98. Are we supersizing El Nino? The rains are falling harder. You know, are we creating hurricanes out of thin air? Of course not. But the concern is that with warmer temperatures, more water vapor, there's more fuel for storms. So when it does rain, it tends to rain much harder. And when it snows, especially along the East Coast, it snows much harder. Most of the biggest snowstorms from Baltimore and D.C. to Boston have been in the last 15 years. Coincidence? Maybe. Thank you for a good question.
Another question down here.
Well, first of all, thank you both for being here. And Mr. Douglas, you've spoken a lot about economic shifts and, you know, changes, but perhaps for the better. And a few moments ago, you spoke about lifestyle changes, maybe on the bit drastic side of all of us riding bicycles and becoming vegetarian. But I'm wondering about your thoughts on more, perhaps more practical social systemic changes, like, for example, investing more in public transit, or various things like that, that would be a little bit of a social system change. You know, what are your thoughts on that? Is it possible? And is that maybe that touch of inconvenience that comes along with that, is that fueling this skepticism?
I think, again, people, it's in our DNA to resist change. You get into a nice, comfortable rut, a comfortable niche. This is what has worked. I'm real comfortable right here. You're telling me I have to change. But reinvention and disruption is a part of life, right? It's not pleasant to have to learn new skills or to have to zig and zag, but show me one industry that has not been disrupted. You know, when I was growing up, people said, well, Paul, if the weather thing doesn't work, you can become a mail carrier. The U.S. Post Office has been disrupted by FedEx and UPS. So nobody gets a free pass.
everybody has to keep iterating and reinventing. And again, in the past, we call this progress. We thought it was a good thing. But now, because we're disrupting some of the biggest, richest corporations on the planet, whoa. But 40% of CO2 emissions come from cities. So smart urban design. Yes, mass transit. Why can't we have a train system in this country like they have in Europe, where the trains show up on time, they're clean, fast? I mean, why did we miss that memo? A new green revolution. I was telling Gary, I had a chance to talk with the folks at General Mills about a year and a half ago, and they wanted a presentation on the meteorological trends. And halfway through it, the CEO, Ken Powell, raised his hand and he said, "Paul, you don't have to convince us that the climate is changing. We see it in our supply chain. We see it in the sourcing of our commodities. What you can tell me right here is where should we be growing cocoa in West Africa? Because the fields where we're growing cocoa today are forecast to be desert within 10 years. These are the kinds of systemic, massive shifts that major corporations are dealing with. And the smart companies aren't waiting. They're going on offense. And I'm really proud to see a lot of Minnesota companies. We had a climate adaptation conference a couple of weeks ago, Gary, and 3M was represented, Best Buy was there, General Mills was there. These big companies are taking it seriously because it is affecting their bottom line. There is more volatility in the climate system. It's showing up in the weather. It's showing up in whiplash between flood and drought. And they're trying to wean themselves off carbon and become more efficient. By the way, people like to ask, "Well, Paul, what's 2 or 3 degrees? Mm-hmm. Minnesota has warmed 3 degrees since 1830, since Fort Snelling. 3 degrees. Mm-hmm. And I usually respond by saying, "When's the last time you were 3 degrees warmer?" And there were symptoms, right? You were sneezing, wheezing, maybe you had night sweats, you were feverish, there was nausea. We're seeing those symptoms now showing up. Not every day, not everywhere simultaneously. But the one thing you can do is broaden your worldview. Don't look out the window. Don't look out the Amish Doppler to get your information. You know, be plugged in. Have a global perspective. Because you know what? What we're discovering, stuff that happens over there, there's blowback. It comes back here. So be aware. Widen your perspective. I think the most important thing you can do is vote at a local and state and national level for men and women who still have a strong respect for science.
See, I want to get to another question here in just a second, but a little follow-up for you. I saw somewhere, in terms of people adapting to changing, the best thing, this argument went, the best thing that people could do is to take a couple of fewer airplane rides every year. Is that true?
Well, there are a lot.
Does flying around cause that much trouble?
It does. It's still a big source. Power generation is still the biggest source. Power generation and transportation. Mm-hmm. You know, if we can gradually wean ourselves off, and it's happening now with mileage requirements going up, it's happening. But yeah. There are still some challenges, but this is why Boeing is working on electric-powered aircraft. And I know it sounds bizarre, but why on earth won't somebody figure that out at some point, or at least a much less polluting form of air travel? But yeah, that's one of many ways that we contribute carbon into the atmosphere.
Yes, sir. Your question, please.
In his recent encyclical, which you cited a few moments ago, Laudato Si, Pope Francis says 10 times in that encyclical, everything is connected. And he specifically wants to connect the problems which especially the rich industrial countries, the problems which he says they have caused primarily. He says the global warming, and he calls it that, is being caused and has been caused by the rich industrial countries. It's not being caused by the poor. And so he links climate change, global warming, and the issues of social justice, because he says the people who are paying the heaviest price are not the rich countries. The people paying the heaviest price are the poor around the world, not only in third world countries, but everywhere. So he, therefore, he speaks of the technocratic paradigm, and he says that technology, yes, it's a wonderful thing. Nobody is suggesting that we go back to the Stone Age, but to some extent, technology is the problem. And we should be careful of looking only to technology as the solution. And so fundamentally, I think the biggest message of his encyclical is that, in fact, what we need is a spiritual conversion. We have to change our attitudes towards nature, towards one another, towards the poor and the disadvantaged. It's a spiritual conversion. As an evangelical and as well and a scientist, would you like to comment on that?
I agree with everything you just said. And this is why, for some people, no amount of evidence will convince them, right? You can pile on the evidence and look at this report from NASA, look at this from NOAA, look at this from the National Science Foundation. People tune out. I think the way to reach people is not only through their heads, but through their hearts. And you ask people, do you love your kids? Do you love your grandkids? Of course I love my kids. Of course I love my grandkids. Then why would you do anything that might potentially make it harder for your family in the future? If there's a 30% probability of a thundershower, you might think to take an umbrella. You know, if there's a 30% chance that the climate scientists are right, and I happen to believe the probability is much higher than that, should we have an insurance policy? So you bring up a very interesting question, and, you know, will technology, in essence, save us from ourselves? For me, what's fascinating, and I do believe in the markets, I do believe that the markets are most in tune with human nature, you know, the good and the bad, and that the solutions we're going to need, the innovations, the revolution we're going to need, is probably not going to come from government. It's not going to be top down. It's going to be bottom up. It's going to be grassroots. It's going to be thousands of new startups dreaming up and testing and launching new ways to power our economy that aren't dependent on carbon. For me, what's fascinating is the notion of sustainable markets. What would sustainable capitalism look like? How can we have everything we think we want and need, no sacrifices, but tread much, much lighter on the earth, less stress on land, water, and air? And I'm happy to see that young people especially are fascinated with this topic, and they're the ones that are going to come up with the solutions. People ask me if I'm optimistic. Some days I feel like I'm swimming upstream, but most days I'm optimistic because of Pope Francis and his encyclical, calling it the way it is, Paris, Moore's Law, the continued drop in the cost of technology, solar dropping 10% a year. We have 4 times more offshore wind capacity than the United States needs every year. And now with energy storage, with these supersized batteries, we have a way of evening out the fluctuations of renewable energy. And it's a long list. And we should be the ones cooking this up. I don't want to be buying my solar panels or my solar film for my windows from China or from Finland or from Israel. I want them to be made right here. Why can't we figure out a way to make that happen faster? Retraining, you know, it's a tragedy what's happening to coal miners. I understand their way of life is being disrupted. Can't we try new things on the training and education, taking advantage of this newfangled contraption? You heard of this, the interwebs, internet?
Oh, it's the internets.
The internets, yes. Yeah. I think it's going to be big. Why can't somebody connect the dots? Why can't we figure out a way to give people the skills they need to be gainfully employed, knowing that it's a moving target? And every business gets disrupted, and we all have to stay flexible. The notion that you're going to graduate and have one job, the same job for 40 years, that worked for your parents and your grandparents, but the world is changing. And I think that's one of the reasons why there's so much unease right now, is that the rate of disruption is increasing between, you know, globalization, automation, computerization. I understand why people are uneasy, and I think this accounts for much of our politics today. It's much easier to give into the fear than to focus on the things that unite us. And I believe that we are all interconnected, and I believe that we are all accountable. We're going to have to answer for, God gave us a gift. Did you keep the gift I gave you in good shape? Were you part of the solution, or were you part of the problem?
Another question down here on this side of the audience.
Yes, you had mentioned unleashing the entrepreneurial spirit. So with that, why is it being held back? And what role does government have in unleashing it?
That's a great question. I don't know if it's being held back. I think it might be more accurate to say, how do we accelerate? How do we turn up the volume? How do we make it easier for startups to succeed? And nobody's asking for a handout, but some of that goes to policy. How do we provide not a safety net, but how do we prime the pump and make it easier for companies to locate in Minnesota, keeping their costs as low as possible while they iterate and experiment and try to come up with the solutions we're going to need? I mean, there's risk. Anytime you launch a company, and none of my five companies have ever turned out the way I thought they would. It's only by the grace of God and surrounding myself with smart people, you zig and you zag, you experiment, you try things up, that didn't work. You keep going until you find a sustainable way forward. And too often startups run out of money. They may have a great idea, great potential, great promise, but they run out of runway. So what can we do? What can state government do to try to help nurture more tech companies, more ag companies? We should be doing for ag what we did for medical devices. I mean, the ag revolution can and should be right here in Minnesota. How do we feed a world of 9 billion people? One that's undergoing more volatility, more swings between drought and heat waves and floods. What worked in the 1980s will not work in the 2020s. So we need to be iterating, testing, inventing. And what can we do to prime the pump? How can we help big established companies, you know, make their supply chains more efficient? I tell people, you know, this isn't all altruism. Going green ultimately puts green back in your pocket. Did Walmart put solar panels on every one of their stores in the United States because they're concerned about the earth? Maybe they are concerned about the planet. They did it to save money. And they passed along those savings to consumers in the form of lower prices. So I think where Republicans get really paranoid is on the regulation side. And if we can find a better way to price that risk in the market and let the markets come up with the inventions, the solutions, that ultimately requires less regulation, that allows more companies to actually succeed, that increases the batting average, I think you're going to get more Republicans coming on board. I'm a naive optimist.
I'm wondering, just from a personal perspective, Paul, what kind of response have you gotten as a TV meteorologist who talked about this issue, as a Republican who's talked about it, as an evangelical who's been talking about it? A lot of negative response, a lot of positive response. What do you hear?
Gary, I'd like you to wade through my emails.
I have my own, Paul.
But here's the thing. You know, I've said this a couple of times. Some things are more important than ratings. Life isn't a popularity contest. You know, when I was on television, I was supposed to be likable. The ratings depended on it, right? And if there's somebody on the air talking, spouting off about climate change, trying to connect the dots, you're going to alienate 15-20% of the audience, which is not viable. But I still think that most people are pragmatic, and people are looking for pragmatic, common sense solutions. And I think there's an opportunity to reinvent the Republican Party. I think younger people are going to be infusing new energy and new optimism, and the Republican Party is going to have to adapt. It's going to have to evolve on this, because I'll tell you what, the symptoms are going to be harder to dismiss, harder to deny over time. So, as a party, are we painting ourselves in a corner that we can't get out of? How do we come up with a pragmatic, common sense approach? What are the things that unite Republicans and Democrats? There are no Democratic thermometers. There are no Republican satellites. The data is the data. The science is the science. And I think it's going to become increasingly untenable for Republicans to stick to this script that, oh, it's not happening, and, oh, if it is happening, it won't be bad, and, you know, if it's bad, then we'll figure out solutions in the nick of time. I'm still optimistic, but there's still going to be some short-term pain before we get there.
More audience questions? There's another person with a question over here on this side. Go ahead.
Mr. Douglas, at what point are these environmental changes going to become catastrophic and irreversible? I've heard a lot of varying information on that, this, like, you know, the inconvenient truth and different articles that are coming out.
That's a great question. And some days I wake up and I wonder, is it going to take a couple of climate catastrophes in the United States to wake up more people? If you live in the Philippines and you were hit by Super Typhoon Haiyan a couple of years ago, sustained winds 220, it's like a 40-mile-wide tornado blasted through Tacloban City. You know, we are seeing evidence of these catastrophes showing up. California's in the midst of the worst drought in 1,200 years. The El Nino helping to take the edge off the drought. South Florida, Miami Beach now floods during a full moon, a king moon. You don't need a storm. Not too many Republicans in South Florida dismissing climate change. They can wade through it on the way to their office. So climate change doesn't hit home until it hits home. But it's going to be hitting home with greater frequency and greater ferocity. And this is what really irritates me, because the Republican Party for the longest time really did seem to value the environment. Teddy Roosevelt launched the national park system. He wanted to preserve, you know, parts of the United States that were extra special. Dick Nixon, you know, nobody would call him an environmentalist, but he launched the EPA. Ronald Reagan even said you have to be very careful about balancing business with the environment. Somewhere along the way, the perception is, at least on the right, that, well, liberals have hijacked that whole environmental thing. It's just an excuse. It's a pretext to grow government, to take away our freedom, to take away our rights. That's the perception. Not the reality, but that's the perception. So how do we come up with a pragmatic approach that nobody's going to be thrilled with, but what's the way forward? And I still think there are ways that we can do that by jump-starting economic opportunities and new ways of reinventing new technologies. But that's not to say that there won't be disruption, especially with coal and oil and natural gas. There will be more disruption.
Paul, you talk about the severe extreme weather events that we've been experiencing. What would explain the 1930s, when we had these wild fluctuations in temperature? We had blizzards, we had droughts, dust bowls. I mean, it was a catalog of climate disasters. Now, that wasn't because of climate change, was it? Or was it?
It was, first of all, it was localized. It was regionalized. We weren't seeing those effects worldwide. We weren't seeing those kinds of extremes on the East Coast or the West Coast. The Plain States, yes, there were crazy swings in the 30s, no question. A lot of record heat, a lot of record cold. But again, if you step back and you just look at the number of record highs versus record lows over the last few decades, 2 to 3 times more record highs than record lows here in the United States. And those trends are also showing up worldwide. So we've always had extremes since the dawn of time. What makes these extremes worse? It's the frequency and it's the intensity of those extremes.
Back here for another question.
Earlier in the evening, you said that this generation and the students here, there's not a lot of pushback, which I think a lot of us would agree with. But what are some steps that this generation could take now?
Again, lead by example. I have a 27-year-old son who works at Cray Supercomputer, and I have a 25-year-old son who flies helicopters for the Navy, graduated from the Naval Academy. And what amazes me is that they don't want the same crap, forgive me, that their parents and their grandparents had. They don't want all the stuff. They don't aspire to the McMansions. They could care less about what kind of car they drive. They want to pay for what they actually use. They derive their joy from experiences, as opposed to owning a warehouse full of stuff that's eventually going to wind up in a landfill. So I think you teaching your parents and your grandparents through your lifestyle that, you know what, I can be just as happy. No, I can be happier by owning less, by having a lighter footprint on the environment. Teach us new ways to live. You know, when I was growing up, it was sort of a form of showing off. You got to have the bigger house, and you got to keep moving up, and you got to have the nicer car and the clothes and the... It's a treadmill, and it's all bunk. In the end, it doesn't matter. None of that matters. So I think new ways, sustainable ways to push forward and to have a full, rich, love-filled life without all of the baggage that this generation has put on life. Show us a better way to move forward. And I know that sounds like Shirley MacLaine kind of tree-hugging, but I really think there is a better way to move forward, a sustainable way to move forward, and your generation will figure out the solutions.
What should we be teaching our kids as they come up through the school system, that, you know, we're ruining the earth, and or the earth is ruined, or, you know, there's an interesting debate going on, or nothing at all? What should we tell our little ones as they go through the school system?
my father, the one thing that comes to mind initially, Gary, my father fled communist East Germany, and he went to college here at Wabash. And he said, you know, he said the Russians were coming in from the East. He said, I will never, ever take my freedom for granted. Americans take their freedom for granted. The other thing he taught me is that actions have consequences. We have rights and we have responsibilities. It's a lot easier. It's much more fun fixating on the rights than it is on the responsibilities. But I think science literacy is part of this. That, I mean, people of all ages have to have a better understanding of how the planet works and how we can nurture and sustain what we have. I think we all take so many things for granted, but I think education is a big part of this. There's a lot of gloom and doom out there, and sometimes you have to wake people up with reality, but I think sociologists will tell you that if you don't provide some hope at the end of the story, people are going to shut down. They're going to curl up in the fetal position. And I think that's, you know, psychologists say that if there is no obvious solution, it's much easier to deny, much easier to dismiss that there is a problem. Turn the page, hand me the remote, let's switch over to ESPN. I don't want to hear this. And there is no silver bullet, but we have silver buckshot. We have lots of silver buckshot, which in the aggregate is already turning the ship. It's a big ship, but it's already turning.
More audience questions? Anybody with a question? Here's one down this way and one back there. Go ahead.
Mr. Douglas, I believe you're familiar with the organization Climate Generation, a Will Steger legacy out of Minneapolis.
Sure am.
And you've been involved in their climate convenings that they had all across the state.
Yep.
They're having one in Albany, just up the road, on Tuesday, February 23rd. And I encourage anybody who's interested in talking more with community members about solutions to climate change to get involved with that event. But my question is, when we're planning these events and we're talking about to people about, you know, use public transportation, don't use plastic water bottles, all of these little steps, do you really think all of those little things are going to add up to the type of systematic change that it's going to take to limit the planet from warming more than 1.5 or 2 degrees? Or is it going to take a lot more than just riding your bike instead of driving your car?
Yeah, as I sip from my suddenly I'm not thirsty, Gary.
Look like glass.
You bring up a good question, and I do have a certain amount of, again, I'm an evangelical Christian. I married a good Catholic girl, and many Sundays I go to Mass. And when I get on a plane, there's a certain amount of Catholic guilt that creeps back in. I have an electric car in the Twin Cities. I'm saving money. It feels like I'm driving for free. Tonight I drove up here in a Ram 1500 Chrysler pickup truck, which I love. So does that make me a hypocrite? Probably. Yeah. But here's the thing. It's because the Tesla will only go 200 miles and I still have range anxiety. But as soon as GM or Ford or Tesla or Hyundai comes out with a pickup truck that's electric, that goes 300 miles, that's reasonably priced, I'm there. And you know what? It's coming. All of these things are coming. The most important thing you can do is support companies that create efficient, low-carbon or carbon-free alternatives. Best thing you can do is support these companies, buy their products, buy their services. And I have a hunch that within a few years, there will be a measure of carbon intensity, kind of like now we throw around GDP. And here's the problem, you know, throughout the arc of history, growth has required energy. Energy has required fossil fuels, not sustainable. not long term. How do we break that cycle? So I think between voting for people that still have a respect for science, be they Democrats, independents, Republicans, and you're going to see more Republicans, I think, swimming upstream and acknowledging the science and making the case for why this will be good for business, that we can have everything we want, but just do so with less stress on the planet, on God's creation.
Yes, sir, your question.
Yeah, Mr. Douglas, I appreciate your optimism that the markets can help solve this large problem. And I'm just wondering what your thoughts are about the upcoming presidential election and whether the outcome of that will matter in terms of will the markets still be able to come up with solutions regardless of who's elected president?
Yes. Yes. That ship has sailed. That ship has sailed. They're already, even though some sort of a fee and dividend or carbon tax is the most preferable solution, there's already a signal in the market. And that came about through the clean power plant from President Obama. Paris, it's a function of what happened in Paris. And it's a function of potential liability on the part of these fossil fuel companies in terms of what did they know when, what did they communicate to investors, what did they do on their own. I mean, follow what's happening with ExxonMobil. And the state of New York right now is trying to figure out, did they basically have two sets of books? One set of books for internal use, hey, yep, it is warming up our science, because they have climate scientists. Our scientists show that the Arctic is warming and this will open up new fields, new possibilities for exploration, new revenue. At the same time, they were funding some of these institutes like the Heritage Foundation, et cetera, to put out disinformation, to confuse the public. It's like tobacco back in the 1970s. I smoked and I remember watching those hearings. You're too young, but I remember watching the hearings. Philip Morris trotted out their paid-for scientists, and they sat there, and with a straight face said, yeah, too bad about Aunt Betty. She smoked three packs a day of Camels. That's so sad she died of lung cancer, but you can't prove that my client's product killed poor Aunt Betty. There's no causal connection. And at the time, those of us who smoked really wanted to believe. We so wanted to believe that there was a free lunch, that we could smoke as much as we want, and we didn't have to worry about heart disease or lung cancer. But there was misinformation. There was another narrative put into the marketplace, and that narrative was bought and paid for by the tobacco lobby because their interests were being threatened. Their business model was under siege. That's what we have today times 1,000, because there are still trillions, trillions of dollars of carbon in the ground, and the richest companies that have ever been want to be able to harvest that carbon indefinitely. Their stock price, their very existence depends on this. So when people push back and, oh, did you see this paper and did you see this and this guy is denying the science, Ted Cruz ranting about the satellite record, he's just proving that he doesn't know anything about science or that he's being fed bad information or that he wants to believe the cherry-picked information. So, sorry to get off on a tangent.
Bottom line, Paul Douglas, as we wrap up, is there... and, you know, put yourself in the position of the devil's advocate. We know what your beliefs are on this, but is there any other possible explanation to what's happening with our climate?
Donald Trump's hair? I'm sorry, please, no nasty tweets from the Donald. And I'm not a good one to be talking about bad hair. But I hope the climate scientists are wrong for the sake of your kids, your grandkids, your future kids. I hope they are wrong. I hope we wake up someday and go, whew, wow. I really do. I'll be the first to shout it from the mountaintop because it will be great news on a planetary scale. I see no evidence of that today. The trajectory still shows warming of the oceans, warming of the atmosphere. Could it be something else that nobody has thought of, that the brightest minds on the planet? Yeah, science is never settled. We're going to not believe the science. We're going to test the science. And that testing will continue. And it will be done by climate scientists who make a good living but could be making far more money in the private sector. So do I think this is all some liberal hoax, some conspiracy? I think that's wishful thinking. And I think it's oversimplifying a very real problem, a problem that we have made over the last 250 years. You know, there's no free lunch. We've built an amazing economy, and we did it using fossil fuels. And we've been using the atmosphere as a convenient sewer. We've privatized profits, and we've socialized costs. That doesn't sound like a free market to me. There really is a tragedy of the commons here. Nobody has the right to put their special interests ahead of the common good. And that's what's happening right now. Not only the industries, but the politicians that keep them in power. So I'm still optimistic because these people here in this room aren't being fooled. They understand what's going on. They understand that actions have consequences, and that what worked in the 1950s will not work in the 2050s. They aren't afraid of progress. They understand that we have to disrupt certain industries. Look what happened to the railroad when the airlines came on board, you know? What happened to the buggy whip manufacturers when the automobile came on board? There was a lot of pushback, a lot of skepticism, a lot of denial, but we kept pushing forward because it was the right thing to do. And so I still think Americans are smart. As a country, we're very smart, very shrewd. You can fool us for a little while, but at some point we're going to come to our senses. And I think America as a nation is coming to its senses right now. The ship is turning. I think we should all be cautiously optimistic, but we all have a ministry. We all have a voice. The situation isn't hopeless. And we aren't helpless.
Paul Douglas, thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
And thank all of you, those of you here at St. John's and those of you listening on the web and on the radio. I'm Gary Eichten. Good evening from the Peter Engel Hall on the campus of St. John's University in Collegeville. Thanks a lot, guys.